Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone, and you've tuned in to a special two-part edition of Soul Facts, a show highlighting the history of legendary artists and their music. Little Willie John's career was at a zenith, traveling through the speed of light, making headline appearances across the country, including Dick Clark's American Bandstand in 1958, and 10 charted hits. He could do no wrong. In the spring of 1957, Little Willie John met and fell in love with a beautiful dancer named Darlynn Bonner and married her in May. They both became proud parents of two sons, William Kevin John in 1958 and Darryl Keith John in 1960. As the new year rang in the new decade, the 1960s, Willie continued his hot streak on the music charts with hits like
Heartbreak.
Walk slow.
Side
Flamingo.
In the sky, flying over the island, take my love on nearby. Take my love.
Take my love.
While Willie was continuing to make hits on the music charts, across the Atlantic, a young band named the Beatles heard Little Willie John's Leave My Kitten Alone through a cover version by Johnny Preston and began to perform it as part of their act. Years later, the Beatles would attempt to add the song on their Beatles for Sale album in 1965, but was unsuccessful. It would take 30 years for the song to be featured on the Beatles' anthology album and CDs in 1995. Around this time, Willie bought a house and moved his family to Miami, Florida. The Prince of the Blues was living the life of a king, succeeding the nightclub scene and throwing lavish down-home barbecue parties in his backyard, entertaining artist friends like Sam Cooke, Donna Washington, Ruth Brown, and a great heavyweight champion boxer named Cassius Clay, known to the world later on as Muhammad Ali. Soon afterwards, the Tower of Happiness came tumbling down, starting in August of 1964, when Willie got into an altercation at a nightclub with a heckler by attacking him with a broken bottle after the heckler threw it on stage while Willie was performing. Then, his label King Records would soon terminate his contract. With no record deal or promotion, Willie traveled to the West Coast with the help of his older sister and singer, Mabel John, set up some gigs for John, including the one at the Magic Inn Lounge in Seattle, the weekend of October 17th through the 18th in 1964. After his last show at 1:30 a.m. on Sunday morning, he and a running partner went to an after-hour spot, met two young ladies, and engaged in a friendly conversation. One of the young ladies excused herself for the moment, leaving her seat empty, Just then, a 6'2", 200-pound ex-con named Kendall Roundtree came over and rudely sat in her seat. When she returned, Willie John politely asked him to relinquish the seat back to the young lady. Some words were exchanged when Roundtree punched John, knocking him to the ground. Allegedly, Willie John picked up a steak knife and stabbed Roundtree in the chest. Kendall Roundtree was pronounced dead at the scene. John was charged with murder, but later posted a $10,000 bond and quickly got out of Seattle the next day to get back to performing the club circuit scene, including the one at the 540 Ballroom in Los Angeles. Willie would return back to Seattle for his trial. After hearing his testimony, the judge first convicted him for 3 years. John again posted bond, this time for $20,000, and continued to perform the nightclub circuit, this time for legal fees. His last triumph appearance was at the world-famous Apollo Theater in Harlem, New York, the weekend of March 4th, 1966. Afterwards, John returned for a second time in Seattle in May of 1966. 2 months later, in July, he began serving a sentence of 8 to 20 years, with a minimum of 7.5. Willie was transferred to Washington State Prison in Walla Walla. 2 years later, on May 26, 1968, little Willie John, the pioneer of soul and prince of the blues, died under mysterious circumstances at Washington State Penitentiary Hospital. He was just 30 years old. His funeral took place at the New Bethel Baptist Church in Detroit on Monday, June 10, 1968, with a gathering of 3,000 mourners, including a who's who in the R&B pop field, who also served as pallbearers. Going on services was provided by the late Reverend C.L. Franklin, father of the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. Tributes from all over paid homage to Little Willie John, including one from his dearest friend, James Brown, recorded an LP entitled Thinking About Little Willie John and a Few Nice Things in late 1968. The legacy of Little Willie John's music continues to be honored through movies such as Big Town in 1986, Lone Star, and the song Fever was featured in Spike Lee's 1990 movie trailer, Jungle Fever. The biggest highlight of Little Willie John's legacy was his induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame on January 17, 1996. The ceremony took place at the Waldorf Astoria in New York City. The great Stevie Wonder inducted and spoke warmly about the artistry and talent of Little Willie John. Afterwards, Willie John's son Keith and mother Darlynn joined the podium and stood and spoke proudly and accepted the award on behalf of Little Willie John. More of the great legacy of Little Willie John continues with a wonderful untold story on the legendary singer entitled Fever, Little Willie John, A Fast Life, Mysterious Death, and The Birth of Soul by Detroit author and music historian Susan Woodall and Kevin John, Willie's son, with a foreword by Stevie Wonder. Calling all TV1 executive staff writers and members and founder Kathy Hughes, an exclusive interview and feature story on Little Willie John for Unsung. The star of Little Willie John continued to shine brightly through the many galaxies of the music universe, trailblazing future Detroit artists up and coming, and putting the Motor City on the musical map. Let's just be thankful that the music outlives the man. I'm the Chancellor of Soul. Thank you. Soul Facts is a show written, created, produced, and copywritten by the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone.